Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Emergency Services. Last August, Stephen Rough phoned 000 to the direction of his GP because he was experiencing excruciating abdominal pain. Esther dispatched paramedics. However, while halfway through assessing him, they were told by Esther to leave him for another call. In significant distress, Stephen's wife drove him to the hospital where he spent the next 7 days. Minister, why are seriously ill Victorians like Stephen being told to drive themselves to hospital if the system is up to standard, as you claim?
Mr. Symes.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Barth for her question and her constituents' experience in August. Ms. Barth, as you've articulated to the House, when you call 000 for an ambulance, the dispatch decision is made by a qualified ambulance dispatch, a dispatcher. They're in a separate team to the call takers, so call takers answer the call and get the basic information and form a view as to whether they can deal with the call, or if it needs an ambulance, it goes to the appropriate sort of triaging situation. And they're then responsible for dispatch because they know where ambulances are and when they can get to people. It's really important to make sure that Category 1 cases are dealt with lights and sirens and given priority, but if there is a more pressing, if a more pressing case becomes available, then that's, as I understand it, is when resources can be diverted to the most appropriate, highest needs incidents. And so the advice that was given to your constituent from those that are best placed to make those decisions sounds what's happened in this case. It would not be for me to provide you a clinical response because I'm not trained, and the people who deal with the people who call 000, who answer the calls, who make the decisions about dispatching ambulances, they are qualified to make those comments, not me. As you would appreciate, everyone that calls 000 doesn't always need an ambulance. In the instance that you've described, it would have come down to them making a clinical decision, and that's I'm glad to hear that he got to hospital and has recovered.
Ms. Barth on a supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister for her response. 5 weeks after Stephen was released from hospital, he experienced serious chest pains. Because the paramedics called to attend his earlier incident had educated him on your policy about when to dial 000, his wife hesitated to phone for an ambulance. Instead, she drove him to hospital to discover he was having a life-threatening heart attack. The lack of clarity and confusion around your policy, Minister, nearly cost Stephen his life. Why do you continue to tell people like Stephen that Victoria's emergency response system is one they can rely on when your policy is endangering his life?
Minister.
That is a complete misconstruction of anything I've ever said. If you are in need of an ambulance, call 000. Absolutely. Like, that's outrageous to suggest otherwise. If you need an ambulance, call 000. I can't be any clearer than this. It's just an outrageous misconstruction of anything I've ever said.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Grimley.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Training and Skills, representing the Minister for Victim Support in the other place. The final report of the Improving Victims' Experience of the Summary Proceedings was tabled in Parliament on the 16th of November 2021. Recommendations 1 and 2 of the report talk about how agencies involved in summary proceedings should provide accessible, co-designed information resources to victims of crime. Further, these resources should be made available in a single place. Recommendation 3 of the report expands on this, saying that agencies involved in summary proceedings should consider improving existing IT systems or developing new systems to allow easier communication of court dates, progress of matters and court outcomes to victims about the case relevant to them. The report suggested this might be through the establishment of a victims portal that would link support services to victims, Victoria Police and court information relevant to the victim. Can the Minister provide a timeline for the implementation of this victims portal?
Mr. Grimley, for his question and his ongoing interest in this area, and I'll refer this matter to the Minister the relevant minister, Minister Hutchins.
Mr. Grimley, on a supplementary.
Thanks, Minister. Thank you, President. Appendix C of the same report gives data from an Engage Victoria survey about victims' experience with summary proceedings. The results point to low levels of compliance by prosecuting agencies with the requirements of the Victims' Charter Act. Here, 63% of respondents said they did not get the opportunity to prepare a victim impact statement. The OPP, who handle part of the summary proceedings caseload, report a high level of compliance with the Victims' Charter Act. In summary proceedings, the Victoria Police, however, are often the prosecuting agency, and it would seem that Victoria Police may be the source of the poor victims' experience, as evidenced in the report. A system to better coordinate victim case management is clearly needed. In November 2020, the Centre for Innovative Justice, in its review of the victim services, suggested the Victoria Police look at adopting both an integrated case management system and a portal for victims of crime. Minister, will you advocate to the Minister of Police so that Victoria Police can take steps to adopt an integrated victim response system, such as the OPP system, to better manage victims' experience with the summary judicial proceedings?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And again, I thank Mr. Grimley for his supplementary question, and similarly to the answer I provided in respect to the substantive, I'll refer the matter to Minister Hutchins.
Minister statement. Ms. Athene.
Thank you. Yesterday, the results of University Australia's 2021 National Student Safety Survey was released. It is deeply concerning and an indictment on our society that sexual harassment and gender discrimination still occurs at universities throughout Australia. The results reinforce the distressing fact that students, especially women and LGBTQIA plus communities, are at risk and that their time at universities will be damaged. President, it is time that we all unite and say stop. As leaders in our communities, we must all ensure that we make it clear that all forms of harassment and violence are unacceptable. We all have a role to play in creating safe, equal and respectful futures, and I am determined to work with Victorian universities and all education providers to eliminate harassment and assault. The report clearly demonstrates that universities need to do more. I have asked the Victorian Vice-Chancellors to provide me with details of their approach and action to tackle this serious problem. It is top of the agenda for the Victorian Vice-Chancellors Forum in April. The Andrews Labor Government has shown leadership. We have implemented the world-leading Educating for Equality to help universities prevent gendered violence in collaboration with Our Watch. We have funded a flagship gender equality and family violence research program at Monash University, which builds on the experience of survivors to develop better responses and prevention measures. And last year, we introduced the Australian First Respect and Equality in TAFE program. There is a lot of work to be done, and this government is absolutely committed to ensuring a safe, equal and respectful future for all Victorians, President.
Thank you. Ms. Burnett-White.
My question is to the Minister for Emergency Services. Minister, isn't it a fact that the Fire Rescue Victoria have one Chief Fire Officer, six Deputy Chief Fire Officers, 57 Assistant Chief Fire Officers and 237 Commanders to manage 3,698 operational staff, while Victoria Police have one Commissioner, six deputy commissioners, 16 assistant commissioners and 13 commanders to manage over 18,000 operational personnel. Minister, how do you explain this byproduct of the Premier's secret deal with Peter Marshall in return for support prior to the 2018 state election?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, President. And having a look to see if there's anything in my folder that has the detail of the operational positions with NFRV. I might have to have a look at that. I'll have to take your word for it on police, because that's not my responsibility. However, I will not be making any apology for the hardworking staff and the investment that this government makes to keep Victorians safe. In relation to to FRV and firefighters. They do a fantastic job, supported by CFA and the volunteers there. And this government has made investments in both agencies, and no doubt will continue, to do so. Under our government, we have increased firefighter numbers because you need to respond to community risk. You need to ensure that people can respond appropriately to incidences that happen in the community. Pretty much, and I wouldn't really say that the organisations are that comparable. They respond to really different things. So I don't think you could say that one particular agency should have the same makeup as another agency. They're also, the way they're structured, the way their different areas are structured, they don't have the same geographical areas of command. They cross over differently. So I just don't think the comparison is very fair. But I guess the crux of your question is that you're concerned about the investment that we make in fire services, and we're not.
Thank you.
Year on year.
Thank you. Ms. Burnett-Wyke on a supplementary.
Thank you, President. Minister, will you seek to have the number of management positions at Fire Rescue reviewed? Is it a fact a ratio of one management position per 12 firefighters compared to one management position per 508 police officers is okay?
Minister.
Ms. Burnett-Wyke, I answered this question in your substantive, in that I don't agree with the position that you can compare these agencies in any way. And again,
to give you better questions next time.
If you're concerned about having too many highly qualified people protecting the state, then that's on you.
Mr. Borman.
Easy, Tiger. Thank you, President. President, my question is directed to the Minister representing the Minister for Transport in the other place. Some time ago, am I being a bit noisy for you, Mr. Jepp? Some time ago, Melbourne City Council banned the parking of horse-drawn carriages in the CBD, forcing them to stage outside the city. There appears to be further effort to entirely remove the horse-drawn carriages from the city. I've been made aware of allegations that Melbourne City Council bylaws officers have been following the carriages in the area, effectively waiting for them to make a mistake so they can be fined. It is further alleged that the Minister for Roads has been enlisted to help out with the removal of the carriages. My contact with the council has resulted in them telling me that all the issues are being driven by the state government and that there is a plan apparently prepared by the state government outlining the path forward, but I'm told neither the council nor the operators are yet to see this plan. My substantive question is, will the minister or a senior advisor reach out to the carriage operators and supply them with a copy of any plan regarding them that exists and properly consult with them to ensure that procedural fairness is given?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Borman for... Where is he? Hello. For his question.
Behind you.
And his interest in this issue, which is obviously a complex intersection between road safety, tourism experience and animal welfare. I think the minister that you're after is Minister Carroll on this particular question, but you're absolutely spot on. This is this is an issue that transgresses multiple areas of government responsibility, because in a city areas where these carriages are, most of the roads are actually council roads. Only a very small number of them are Vic roads, managed roads. So I will take that question on notice in accordance with our standing orders and seek a response from Minister Carroll for you.
Mr. Borman on a supplementary.
Thank you, President. I thank the Minister for answer. The carriage operators want to continue their business, but like all tourism-related businesses, COVID restrictions have decimated the operators. And even though we are starting to come out of the pandemic, there seems to be some sort of concerted effort to finish this particular business off. So my question is that in the event that regulation or legislation that is enacted that further restricts the operation of the horse-drawn carriages to the point they are not able to run a viable business, will the government commit to ensuring that a fair and reasonable compensation package is given to the carriage operators?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Mr. Borman, for your supplementary question. I'll seek a response to the issues that you've canvassed from Minister Carroll.
Thank you. Minister's statement, Minister Pulford.
President, the Andrews government is proud to be providing small business owners with free access to Mind Armour, an evidence-based online mental health support tool. Mind Armour is being made available to Victorian small businesses and their employees to help with daily challenges and the ongoing uncertainty due to the pandemic. Supported by the Black Dog Institute and the University of New South Wales, Mind Armour is an education program developed by leading researchers. Through 10 short interactive sessions accessible on a computer, tablet or smartphone, users learn mindfulness and cognitive techniques for resilience and to manage workplace stresses. Sally Wallace from Melbourne's Roam to Rome travel business recognised her staff needed additional wellbeing support during the pandemic. Mind Armour tailored a program specifically for their 40 staff members with an emphasis on resilience, practical skills and strategies. This program forms part of the Labor government's $26 million commitment to providing timely and needs-based support through the Wellbeing and Mental Health Support for Business initiative announced back in August 2020. Other initiatives include the Partners in Wellbeing Helpline, a free and confidential service that provides support for small business owners and their employees with wellbeing coaching, financial counselling and business advisory services. Available 7 days a week, and the small business edition of the WorkSafe Work Well toolkit supporting small business owners and sole traders to create mentally healthy workplaces. In addition, Business Victoria is still accepting applications for the Mental Wellbeing of Business Committee's grants program, which offers eligible local traders groups and business chambers free mental health training, plus grants of $15,000 to deliver a related project. With the remaining time available to me, though, I would like to express my profound admiration for our small business community and their determination to look after the well-being of their employees and indeed themselves and their families through what has been an extraordinary and unprecedented set of circumstances. We're proud to work with them to enhance what is available to support them to do that.
Fine. Mr. Davis. Order. Order, please. Thank you.
My question is to the Minister for Small Business and concerns the ProBuild collapse and administration of its impact on small business. ProBuild was responsible through its subsidiary WBHO Construction for the Western Roads Package, a $1.8 billion state roads package and construction program in the western suburbs. ProBuild has finished this project, which is now administered through an ongoing 20-year PPP arrangement. However, concerningly, WBHO has not paid all the construction and building firms who built the project. This is inconsistent with state government commitments on security of payment for state works. And I ask, what steps will the Small Business Minister take to ensure hard-working contractors who have completed this project don't go broke, effectively being left to whistle Dixie?
Minister Pulford.
Thank you, Mr. Davis, for your question. So the government has been monitoring closely the situation with ProBuild, and I can provide an update to the update that I provided the last sitting week, a fortnight ago, and my department continues to be in contact with ProBuild since their announcement in the last fortnight. Let me say at the outset, I offer our full support for affected workers through the Worker in Transition program and Jobs Victoria, so that I want people to know that they have that support. But where the current state of affairs is that it's our expectation that the company will honour all of their legal obligations to workers and subcontractors. We'll also provide ProBuild with appropriate business facilitation services as the administrator, which is Deloitte, pursue the options of a new owner. The Victorian government has no direct contracts with ProBuild at this time, and I know that Mr. Davis's question did go to a whole bunch of other areas of ministerial responsibility. Obviously, there are a number of portfolios that are impacted by this significant event. So ProBuild have advised that they are working with the administrator on plans to protect clients, subcontractors and employees, and my department's engagement with those who are impacted by this, whether they are small businesses or large businesses or independent contractors or individual self-employed people, will continue.
thank the Minister for her answer, but the truth of the matter is a copy of the minutes of the liquidators, Deloitte's meeting on the 4th of March, contains the names of Victorian firms involved in the WBHO construction of the Western Roads package, who have not yet been paid. Will the Minister thereby therefore insist that each and every contractor is paid in full for the work they have done on the State Government's Western Road package?
Mr. Pulford.
Thank you, President. Mr. Davis has asked about the actions that occur when things are being liquidated. What I have outlined is the process that Deloitte is working through, the endeavours to find a new purchaser, the support for workers who are impacted by what has happened with ProBuild. Whilst I think we have a point of order, President.
Order. Dr. Cumming, on a point of order.
President, I'm really struggling today with some of the comments that I've been hearing from across from the government around inappropriate behaviour. As somebody who has been abused by an alcoholic, I'm absolutely disgusted at some of the things that I've been hearing out of these gentlemen's mouths.
Thank you. Members, please, thank you. Dr. Cumming, and you raise your point of order. So, members, please, we all know we should behave very well in the chamber and outside the chamber. Minister.
Look, thank you, President. And I think in the circumstances, you know, people are being restrained. Mr. Davis has made his apology, and I would concur, President, with your comments about the standing of members of Parliament both in and out of the chamber and when we're at public events. But this is an important question that Mr. Davis has asked. And I might just, with your forbearance, a couple of seconds so I can finish the answer to that question. I will ask that my department engages with the Department of Transport around the contractual arrangements in the Western Roads project upgrade to make sure that people who are in this situation are provided with appropriate support, and I undertake to do that.
Thank you. Dr. Cumming, and please, and the members on my right, enough is enough. Dr. Cumming.
Thank you, Mr. President. And my question is for the Premier in the other place. Can the Premier confirm that Q and R codes were reintroduced without any health advice to do so? On the 25th of February, the New South Wales Premier, Dominic Perrottet, delivered his first State of State in front of a packed room in Sydney, hosted by CEDA. Now, Premier Perrottet was asked a question regarding collaborating with the other state premiers, such as Mr. Andrews. In his response, he went to say that it was important that New South Wales and Victoria had similar settings to avoid media criticism. He gave the example of reintroducing Q&R settings, saying that there were no need for them to be reintroduced as contact tracing was no longer being carried out.
Neither of the government. No.
Oh, sorry. Would you like me to repeat the question?
Repeat the first
part. Can the Premier confirm that Q&R codes were reintroduced without any health advice to do so?
Thank you.
President, I'll pass Dr. Cumming's question on to the Premier for response.
Dr. Cumming on a supplementary.
Thank you, President. I look forward to the Premier's response. Can he confirm that the decision to reintroduce rapid antigen testing to schools at the beginning of this year was not supported by health advice? Premier Perrottet went on to speak about the return of children to classrooms, another instance of the two premiers making a joint decision. He said that there was a concern that the media would find that, and I quote, the scariest epidemiologist who is out there saying every child in New South Wales would die. Both premiers decided to buy millions of RAT tests and issued them to schools and childcare centres. He went on to say that the health completely disagreed with the approach, but it was done to instill confidence and minimise the negative media coverage. to appease the teachers, to appease the parents?
Leader of the Government.
Thank you, President. Whilst I'm happy to, to put your question to the Premier, it involves more likely the Health Minister and the Education Minister, but I'll bundle it up and see what comes back for you.
Mr. Statement, Mr. Lean.
Thank you, President. On Labor Day, I was very lucky to be in the beautiful location of Jamison for the official opening of the Matthews Reserve Avenue of Honour. The Jamison community planted the Avenue of Honour of Japanese maples in the 1920s to acknowledge the 51 local residents who served during World War I. Some work had been done in recent times, and there was a bit of a relaunch of this particular Avenue of Honour. And I'm pleased that our government, through the Victorian Remembers Program, funded 51 bespoke brass plaques. The plaques display the name of each World War I veteran, handwritten by the children at Jamison Primary School, with some names written by the descendants of the veterans. Craig Urey, the local artist, crafted the plaques, and they're fantastic. So can I thank the Jamison community for welcoming me? I also travelled to East Gippsland and dropped into the Barnsdale, whichever street side of the street you are, RSL, and caught up with Alan Patton, very, very good man. 400 veterans members at that particular RSL, and I had a great meeting with them around a number of issues, including the Royal Commission into Defence Force. And then I was lucky enough to go to the Carry On Cafe and launch their new Veterans Wellbeing Hub in Morwell. A magnificent facility which holds a food bank service, veteran social space, multi-purpose room for group exercise, and also some one-on-ones as far as advocacy for DVA welfare claims. And can I congratulate David McLaughlin and his team for the magnificent work they do right across the state.
Thank you, Mr. Davis.
President, my question is to the Minister for Workplace Safety. Minister, how much will be spent on advertising and promotion of the government's business employing casuals scheme that is announced?
Mr. Sitt.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Davis for his question about what is a very, very important initiative of our government, and that is to tackle the scourge of insecure work in our labour market, and one in four Australians occupy casual or insecure employment, and that is something that is a significant problem, because it means that one in four workers.
Yeah, but I understand that. But she was only for 5 seconds, and the interjection started. Minister, to continue.
Thank you, President. The point that I was making is that these workers across our state who occupy casual and insecure employment are often facing significant financial disadvantage. And we've heard a bit in this chamber this week about what people's views are about disadvantage, and I can tell you that our views about disadvantage and inequality is that we are going to tackle them, and we are doing so through this scheme. And in relation to the $245 million investment that our government has made to the two-year trial, we will be setting aside $1.5 million to ensure that both employers and workers understand the rules and the obligations under this scheme. There will be a hotline that is set up at the department to ensure that people who are affected by the scheme and who want to ensure that their rights are upheld can get advice, professional advice from the department. There will be obviously a digital print and TV component which will ensure that people are aware of the ability to apply for sick pay in the event that if they are in one of the targeted industries, they can access up to 5 days a year of sick pay. We make no apology as a government for ensuring that the community understands these very important initiatives that our government is pursuing.
Mr. Davis, on a supplementary.
So the President, point here is that the Minister has indicated a significant advertising campaign, and I ask, will the Minister provide a guarantee that none of the millions of planned advertising will be sourced from the $245.6 million the government has initially allocated for this scheme, or will it be extra?
Thank you, Minister State.
Well, I thank Mr. Davis for his question. I'm not sure what he's proposing here. Is he proposing that this is not an important initiative to tackle insecure employment and to ensure that the very people who are often at the margins in our community, that we make sure that we are reaching those communities that are the hardest to reach? And if we can't take the learnings from the pandemic over the last 2 years, that often people are not plugged into mainstream media and we need to take different approaches to make sure they understand their rights and obligations, then we are missing a huge opportunity. And our government is absolutely committed to making sure that this $245 million scheme tackles the problems the inequality in our labour market, and that's exactly what we will be doing.
Mr. Hayes.
Directed to the Minister representing the Minister for the Environment, Energy and Climate Change. The Legislative Assembly's recent Environment and Planning Committee's inquiry into the environmental infrastructure requirements for growing populations raised some significant issues. Victoria's environmental infrastructure is considered fundamental to the livability of urban Melburnians, particularly in times of COVID, for outdoor open space, physical activity and a wide range of health benefits. Will the Minister be embracing these recommendations, particularly those relating to the sale of surplus government land, which could be instead used for public open space, increased funding for Parks Victoria and a consistent reporting framework for tree canopy targets?
Mr. Lane.
Mr. Hayes, for the question, that was a question directed to the Minister for Environment, and I'll make sure she gets your question and you get your response in line with what's prescribed in the standing orders.
Mr. Hayes on the supplementary.
Thanks, President, and thank you, Minister. Minister, rapid population growth in inner and outer Melbourne continues to be an ongoing challenge. As the population grows, so does the demand for existing open space grow. DELP's submission raised concerns about urban areas where only fragments of native vegetation and natural habitat remain, stressing the importance of our parks, gardens, waterways and urban forests to support our remnant biodiversity. The real loser of this urban sprawl has been our green wedges and western grasslands, which remain under urban development pressure. I'm interested to find out from the Minister if she will consider recommendations 34, 35 and 36, which ask the government to consider bringing forward the acquisition of land required to establish the western grasslands and to develop a tree protection policy for adoption in all growth areas.
Celine.
Thank you, President. Once again, thank you, Mr. Hayes, for your supplementary, and I'll ensure that the question which is directed to the Minister of Environment is sent to her and you get a response in line with the standing orders.
Thank you, Mr. Stateman. Mr. State.
I rise to update the House on how the Andrews Labor government is providing families in Hobsons Bay with more and better kindergarten facilities. Earlier this week, we announced the signing of a new building blocks partnership with Hobsons Bay City Council that will deliver a co-contribution of up to $5.8 million towards three new and expanded kinders as part of our landmark three-year-old kindergarten reform. We know how important it is for Victorian children to get the best start in life, and we're delivering the facilities to do exactly that. The first stage of this partnership will provide an extra 168 funded kinder places by 2025 across Newport, Altona and Seabrook. And I want to give a shout out to the members for Williamstown, Melissa Horn, and Altona, Jill Hennessy, for their tireless advocacy on behalf of their communities. They both understand the critical role that early childhood education plays in setting children up for lifelong learning. There's also in principle support for a further state government contribution of up to $2 million for one more new kinder in the city of Hobsons Bay to be delivered from 2026. The projects will deliver more than 270 funded kinder places in total in the city of Hobsons Bay by 2029. This is the third building blocks partnership we've signed, and I want to encourage every council to engage in this process so we can deliver even more bigger and better kinders across Victoria.
Thank you.